Greetings, racers, and welcome to the AutoWare complimentary class on Data Acquisition Basics. My name is John Block. I am your instructor today, and today's class is recorded, unlike our regular sessions that are live on the internet. That way, if something is not quite clear or if you have a question, you can stop me at any point and we can stay at that spot in the information and cover what's necessary. Today, however, we're going to cover the basics of data acquisition, and it's really a lot more simple than you would imagine. Actually, it's just kind of a logical outgrowth of technology from the last 40 or 50 years. For example, who hasn't heard of a telephone answering device? These are very simple machines. Basically, it's just some kind of a recorder that records information from a sensor. For example, you have your telephone here, and you have a sensor, which is basically a microphone, and that information comes through the wire electronically, and then it gets recorded in the answering machine. That is basically a data acquisition system. From that, it was not too big of a step for it to actually start being employed in cars. We had pollution control devices that quickly led to electronic engine controls, and then we had the early versions of onboard diagnostics, OBD, and then later the government started mandating it, and by 1996 all cars sold in America had to have the OBD2 system, which in essence is just another data acquisition system. You can see here in the little drawing that it's basically your ECU in your car is a recorder, it's a logger, and it has sensors connected to it, and you'll have a wire that runs out to the sensor and it's providing 5 volts, and that might be a throttle position sensor, an O2 sensor, but whatever the sensor is measuring, it returns a voltage between 0 and 5 back to the ECU. And that's where it is recorded. And at that point, we have our modern data acquisition system. Now, we also have different scan tools. I have a scan tool I like to use. It plugs into the car, into the dash. The other end goes onto my laptop, and then I use my laptop as my scanner. There are all sorts of little handheld scanners, but basically we've got a box that records information. Connected to that box are sensors, and then somehow we download that information to view ourselves. All right, well, that is really, in essence, just like a modern day data acquisition system. Here is a picture of a very useful and affordable budget data acquisition system. You can see here the item labeled A is the recorder, or what we call a logger in data acquisition terms. And then you have all sorts of sensors that can be connected to your logger. And you can have suspension sensors, throttle position sensors, speed sensors, all sorts of things. Likewise, things have developed just like everything else with computer technology. And now, you can see in this photograph, you can have actual little dashboards in your car. The logger and sensors are recording information, and it can also be displayed on a little dashboard. So you can see speed, engine vitals such as RPM or oil pressure, and even shift lights. Basically, it's just an outgrowth of that old telephone answering machine when you think about it. Now, some data systems are temporary and some data systems are permanent. Here is a photograph of a temporary data system. It's in a NASCAR Cup car. Of course, they're not allowed to race with these things, so you have to use it for testing. But here you can see the logger is simply mounted on a little piece of aluminum that is hose clamped to the roll cage. and then all the various wires run at the different components on the car to record information. Now, one thing you need to understand is that the recorder is not like the answering machine. We're just going to get a continuous voice like you hear me right now. Actually, those record kind of in frames like a movie. If you think of looking at a movie this way, we see the motion. But if we were to take that movie and turn it sideways and think about the individual frames in a movie, these data loggers record that same way as individual frames. Now, it may record 10 frames a second, 50 frames a second, or even up to 400 or 1,000 times per second. It's just running out and checking the voltage and recording that information in the logger. So we have all these different sensors that can be connected to the logger. Here is an example of a suspension sensor. Basically, they're just what are known as rigid linear potentiometers. We call them POTS. But basically, just based on the stroke, the POT returns a different voltage back to the logger. Here is another photograph. Here is on an actual street stop. So everybody's using these days. You can see the arrow is pointing to the suspension sensor. And in this photograph, this is a permanent fixture on a sports car. You can see the arrow points to the sensor that is running parallel to the shock. These are really nice because we not only get information about the shock, but we get information about the suspension. So we now have an idea of what's happening with roll or dive or, you know, heave. And we also get information about shock velocities, lots of real fun things there. But it's not just limited to suspension. Just like your car has a throttle position sensor, you can see in this photograph here is a sensor placed on a manifold and connected to a carburetor to identify throttle position. Likewise, we can have steering sensors. Here's a photograph of a rigid sensor connected to a drag link in a steering system. This is one way of measuring steering. There are all sorts of ways. You can use a sensor like the throttle position sensor and just have the little wire wrap around a steering column. You can have them with two little pulleys, if you will, and a little kind of rubber band belt, if you will, running back and forth. There's a lot of different ways you can measure these things. And there really is nothing magic about the sensors. They typically come out of aerospace or even the automotive industry these days. Also, we can have brake pressure sensors. You can see in this photograph, there's a little sensor plumbed into the brake line that measures brake pressure. So all of these different sensors, whether it is lateral G, yaw rate to see how much the car is rotating, tire temperatures, it's almost unlimited on what you can measure. But basically, all of these sensors just take the output voltage, that 5 volts that came from the logger, returned it back as some reduced voltage, and that's how the system records what happened on your car. And that's basically all there is to a data system. Not as scary as you might think they are. So that's it for this first video. We will have a follow-up video where we'll show you how you can get that information out of the logger and in a form that we humans can understand. So, hopefully you enjoyed this, and please enjoy the second video, and think about signing up for our regular classes where we take the data a lot farther than this. We can identify oversteer, understeer. We know if you had a push-loose condition. We can tell if it was driver-induced, whether it's springs, shocks. There's almost no limit to what you can do with this data acquisition. We also have our advanced classes, where we show you how to take a modest data system and turn it into a rolling engine dyno, where you can actually see the shape of your horsepower curve. We also, in the advanced class, show you some little techniques on how you can take a modest data system and actually turn it into a rolling wind tunnel. We can identify the coefficient of drag, coefficient of lift. We can tell if you've got lift or downforce, and we can even get to the point where we can identify where the vertical center of pressure is in your downforce or your lift, front to rear in the car, just with a modest data system. So please take a look at our other classes and join. Thanks. Bye-bye.